It'll be at Rock Hall, which naturally raises a fundamental question. You have an important decision to make in your educational life. Namely, will I first play, will I educate you about the history of the string quartet, or will I educate you about the history of blues leading to the rock and roll? How many people for the string quartet? Blues leads the rock and roll. Robert Johnson it is, yes.
Is that 7 to 10 or 7 to 9 a.m. or p.m.?
That is a sick question. This guy has a problem. This is p.m. And I think the rule is that after 7, you can drink in classrooms. I think. That's just a conjecture. Right. What about the exam? So the exam, you don't need a Scantron. There are no multiple choice questions. It's all short answer, few sentences, do calculations to get in. And I'll show you the cover of the exam. I'll distribute it today when I post today's lecture notes. The hardest homework problems are definitely harder than the hardest exam problems because you have more time to think about the homework. The problems are much like the homework problems, but more interesting. What else? On Friday, so I know this will be of increasing interest, on Friday we'll have office hours from 9 to 5, nonstop, in a room in the basement of the store hall. So there'll be a TA available, there'll be TAs available for 8 hours, and I'll have extra office hours on Thursday, and I'll have the review session on Friday. Okay, so, before we were rudely interrupted by the weekend, I wanted to talk about Morgan's Cross 2. White females. So the cross is XW plus Y, XW. Okay. And what you expect for the F1, and what you almost always get, white males and red females. Okay, that's the standard result from that cross with X-linked inheritance. But Morgan, in his paper in 1910, noted that occasionally he got exceptional progeny. So exceptional. Exceptional. I'm sure you've heard it many times before, but science often advances when people understand exceptions. So you think you understand some principle that gives you this pattern. You'll understand that principle often more deeply if you can ask, well, okay, that's the way it's supposed to work. Why doesn't it always work that way? Can I sort out the exception? And by figuring out what exception, one often figures out, understands much more deeply what's going on. The exceptional F1s, so this is what you expect. These are, if you like, the normal progeny. The exceptional F1s are red eye. Let me just say red males and white females. Red males and white females. And the question that Bridges took for his dissertation, so this is Calvin Bridges. And he first published in 1914, basically an announcement saying, I figured this problem out. And here's the answer. And then he published this extraordinary set of two back-to-back papers in volume one, number one of genetics that occupy 130 pages, where he elaborated this three-page note saying that he had figured this problem out. Bridges 1914, followed by 1916 AB. That's the 1916 AB, where Bridges lays it out in detail. But he noticed that the exceptional males so you do this cross, he did this cross hundreds of times, looked at thousands of progeny, and these exceptional F1s, these are on the order of one in a thousand progeny. So this sort of began the era of heroic Drosophila experiments, where people looked at hundreds of individuals to understand what's going on. So my postdoc and I, with a friend, just published a paper in genetics, looking at this phenomenon I studied, cytoplasmic compatibility, where we scored hundreds of thousands of eggs. So this tradition of doing ridiculous amount of work to understand something. Notice that the exceptional males were all sterile. And he hypothesis. So the game is to have a hypothesis that makes a prediction about something that you've not yet observed. Hypothesis was that the exceptional progeny, exceptional F1, arose from X chromosome non-disjunction. Female parent. So here's his hypothesis. The hypothesis, Bridges' hypothesis, which he proved cytologically, which he proved by looking at the chromosomes, he hypothesized that there was a chromosomal explanation. So Morgan, 1910, says that X is inherited as if it's on the sex chromosome. I learned something this weekend. It's embarrassing, I didn't know this before. So who first figured out that this is male and this is female in Drosophila melanogaster? And the answer is a woman named Nettie Stevens. So Nettie Stevens, in a paper she published in 1908, so Morgan and Bridges were actually building on this woman's work, who sadly died in her 40s of breast cancer. She was one of the first female professors of genetics. A brilliant woman. Morgan said she was the best student he ever had, which is pretty amazing, given that one of the students got the Nobel Prize, and the other two were widely recognized as geniuses. But Nettie Stevens sorted this out. She was clearly a brilliant cytologist. Bridges and Morgan built on this. So what is this X non-disjunction hypothesis? I learned a bunch of stuff this weekend. Are you ready? You're all sitting down. You're not going to fall over. So we all know that the way meiosis works, meiosis one is homologs disjoint, and meiosis two is sisters disjoint. Right? Learned that in high school. I learned this weekend, and I've never heard this before, that some organisms do it in the reverse direction. I mean, how wrong is that? How wrong is that? And forget the fact that I said that, okay? Don't think about that. But this goes with the, I'll have students read this paper next year. But it goes with the fact that there's all this evolution going on with respect to meiosis. The most fundamental things about meiosis are constantly turning over because of intragenital conflict. Okay, back to the normal program. What we expect these females to produce all XW ova, right? I mean, we expect all the gametes of a female to carry one X chromosome, and that X chromosome will carry the white allele, because that's all mom has to give. She's homozygous for white. Non-disjunction refers to an extraordinary meiotic event, a rare meiotic event, whereby the female produces no gametes. Meaning, she produces some gametes that carry two X chromosomes and other gametes that carry no X chromosomes. I sort of went directly to the exceptional place, but let's do the Punnett square. The Punnett square, and we'll put the male gametes here, and we expect male gametes to be XW plus and Y. We expect female to always be like that. Okay, so we expect it to be quite simple. So this is the normal situation. That's the normal situation where the female produces white-bearing gametes. And the male produces alternative gametes. These males are white-eyed, these females are red-eyed. What happens exceptionally, so this is about 999 over 1,000, the rare events, and I don't expect you to memorize numbers like that because they're very much dependent on the genetic stock and a bunch of other things. But occasionally, on the order of 1 in 1,000 times, these non-disjunction events occur. These non-disjunction events occur. And of non-disjunction events, so meiosis is always symmetrical. If two X chromosomes go one way, nothing goes the other way. So what happens here? What happens with this exceptional meiotic event that produces four types of embryos? Those embryos are XW plus, XW, Y, XW, XW, X, XW plus, an individual has only one sex chromosome, these individuals have three, and another individual that has only one sex chromosome, and it's the Y. So the question is, what's up? So, Bridges' hypothesis was that these were the exceptional male, that these individuals that get an X from dad and have no Y are males but sterile, and his hypothesis was that these individuals were the exceptional females. And that these individuals died. Turns out, not quite true. Under some circumstances, a few of these individuals were survived, but we will ignore that. General rule. So remember what I told you last time about the Drosophila karyotype, that the X is about 20%. Of the gene content of a fly. On the order of 20% of the genes live on the X chromosome. These individuals have three copies of 20% of their genes. Is that okay or not? Well, you don't know, right? There's no reason a priori to know whether or not that's okay. And the answer is, it's not okay. The answer is that these are the individuals will occasionally survive, but rarely. What's particularly interesting about that, and I'll say more about this next time, is that if you have three copies of all of your chromosomes, if I create a fly, and I can create a fly, that has three copies of the X, three copies of the second, and three copies of the third, that is a viable fly. It's not a happy fly, but it is a viable and indeed fertile fly. You can breed, that's called a triploid in there. So we're diploids, two copies of each chromosome. Triploids in flies are viable, and females, triploids are fertile. Okay? Yet, those individuals are almost always dead. A lesson, fundamental genetics lesson, about gene dosage. So all these genes are participating in all these biochemical pathways, elaborate biochemical processes, genes interacting with one another. Dosage is important. Okay? You can screw around around the edges with dosage, but if you go messing with a fifth of the genome, it's going to be bad news. In contrast, we have the little fourth. We have the little fourth that's about 2% of the genome. 2% of the genome, you can get away without having any fourth chromosome. Get away with one, get away with three, get away with four. So there's this interesting question about how much can you play with dosage. Among the many important topics that I'm not going to lecture on is dosage compensation. You know, how does the heterogenetic sex deal with the fact that it only has one sex chromosome instead of two? And the answer is it's dealt with in many different ways across the tree of life. We just don't have time to talk about it. So Bridges hypothesized that the exceptional males and females arose from non-disjunction events. He then concluded that Y is needed for male fertility. So he hypothesized that these females would have arisen, those red-eyed females, for the males getting an X chromosome from dad. They don't have a Y, they're sterile. He says his conclusion must be that you need a Y to be a fertile male. So what's interesting about this is that it's a hypothesis in terms of the karyotypes of the individuals. He predicted under his hypothesis that if he looked at the exceptional, individuals, so predictions. These are psychological predictions. Okay? Remember, we're establishing the chromosome theory of inheritance, that genes are in chromosomes. Hence, you make a phenotypic observation and you predict what is going on with respect to the chromosomes. The predictions were one, exceptional males have no Y, and then Stevens pointed out the Y is the easiest thing to see. You don't miss the Y. It has a different morphology from the autosomes. In Drosophila, it's easy to see that in somatic cells. And hypothesis two is that the exceptional males have no Y, exceptional females have a Y. They have two X's plus a Y chromosome. And Bridges, these are the data, and he has beautiful drawings of this, shows what the karyotypes look like, and shows indeed that that was true. Being a good boy, Bridges made further predictions that he tested. So what Bridges then did was to take his exceptional females, and mate them to normal males. Okay, so things look pretty darn good so far, psychological predictions, and conclusions based on his data. So he said here, he concluded, first he concluded having no second X chromosome that can kill you. He also concluded that males that don't have a Y chromosome will be sterile. Additional tasks. I forgot to say something that's important. When does non-disjunction occur? There are two phases of meiosis, meiosis one and meiosis two. When does non-disjunction occur? Answer anytime it wants to. It can occur either at meiosis one, the homologs cannot disjoin, or it can occur at meiosis two, when the sisters don't disjoin. Okay? And it's an interesting source of exam problems to think about the consequences of non-disjunction at stage one versus stage two. Okay, so we're going to take these exceptional females, those females there, XWY, these are white females, he's going to mate them to red males. We know and love this cross. So usually, usually white female, by red male, should produce one half the progeny should be red-eyed females. Those females get X from dad, and half of the progeny should be white males. But what does it get? So remember, this is the cross. This is precise, phenotypically, this is the cross that almost always produces this result. But now he's doing the cross not with a normal wide-eyed female, but with an exceptional wide-eyed female, a stock that he knows has the females carrying a Y chromosome. So the question is, the biological question, what does meiosis do with this? So meiosis knows what to do when there are two sex chromosomes. They're supposed to disjoin. What does meiosis do with this configuration? So we call this a trisomic. If you have three copies of one chromosome, so a diploid is disomic for each of its chromosomes. This individual is trisomic, has three copies specifically of the sex chromosomes because it has the supernumerary Y. Now we're doing that cross with these exceptional females, and what's observed, result is 96%. Red females. 96%. So, in other words, 48% of these and 48% of those, but 4% exceptional. 4% white female and red male. As I said, in a normal cross, exceptional are really exceptional, on the order of 1 in 1,000. Now suddenly, we have 4% exceptions, i.e., so exceptional females produce exceptional progeny. And it reflects the fact that when you're a trisomic, what meiosis does, meiosis is sort of confused. The X's, so it produces XY versus X about 96% of the time, and XX versus Y about 4%. You'll see why I'm fudging this a bit. So versus disjunction always involves some stuff going left, the other stuff going right. If X and Y go left, the other X goes right or up or down. If two X's go one way, the Y goes the other. So, you know, there would be a very small chance of all three going in one pole. That's negligibly rare. So the question is, if that's the outcome of meiosis, what do the progeny look like, and are there additional predictions? So let's look at the progeny. We're mating those females to normal white-eyed males. Okay. So our male gametes, are simple. Our male gametes are going to be XW and Y, equally frequent. But now, we're going to have four classes of female gametes. Okay. The common class, so we expect about 48%, we expect about 0.48 to be, and this female is white-eyed. White-eyed female, sorry, this is red-eyed male. Let me not confuse myself. The white-eyed female is going to throw about 48% of her gametes will have an X. She's homozygous white. The complementary gametes, white, versus XW versus Y. Now we're going, so those four classes of female gametes going against these two types of male gametes, going to produce eight classes of embryos. What are the eight classes of embryos? Well, we just do the Punnett square. And so just fill this in. This individual has two Y's. Okay. So now we have eight classes of embryos. Of those eight classes of embryos, well, these individuals are in trouble. They don't have an X chromosome. You can't lose 20% of your genome and go down the road. These individuals have three copies of 20% of the genome, everything else in two copies. That doesn't work. So what do we have left? What we have left are females of three flavors. We have females of three flavors. We have females who look. So this is 96% of the gametes look like this. So these are the most common females. These are the common. So the most common phenotypically. Female progeny, most most,
you know,
over 95% are red females. They're rare. Rare white females. Rare white females. Okay. What's painfully pretty about this is that it produces a strong prediction. A strong prediction. All of the white-eyed females have to have a Y. Of the red-eyed females, half have a Y, half don't. So predict. So our psychological model predicts all rare. All rare white females are all rare white females have a Y, which is easy to see cytologically. Predict one, two, half of the most common red females have a Y. And then the prediction is that half of those females will produce exceptional progeny from non-disjunction quite frequently. The males that come out of this cross will be most of them will be white-eyed. The rare ones will be red-eyed. The red-eyed males now are fertile. This will all be in the notes. The red-eyed males are fertile. It turns out that having two Ys is okay. So all males are fertile. Irrespective of eye color, including these rare ones, because they have a Y chromosome. And that follows directly from the cytology. And his conjecture in the previous experiment that you need a Y to be fertile. Anyway, this is basically Bridges' dissertation and Morgan's original work, plus the work by the student Alfred Sternowitz, I'll talk about next. Those three things got Morgan the first Nobel Prize in genetics. So they say Mendel was the founding father of genetics, but Thomas Hunt Morgan is the founding father of modern genetics in terms of associating the genetic material with chromosomes and arguing that those genes are linearly arranged on chromosomes. So that's where we're going to go next. Yeah, terms. A primary, secondary, non-disjunction. So I had a Japanese friend, Tarui Wakai, extremely distinguished Japanese population geneticist who studied mutations and the accumulation of deleterious alleles. His requirement for anyone who wanted to get a PhD with him is that you had to do experiments where cumulatively you had counted a million flies. So to get out of his lab, you had to have counted a million flies. So primary non-disjunction has to do with a normal diploid. A normal diploid producing producing an abnormal gamete. An abnormal gamete, meaning a gamete that, i.e., number of copies of a chromosome less than one or bigger than one. You want to have one copy of each. If you have less than one or more than one, you're abnormal. We talk that abnormality, we talk about these as aneuploid. Versus euploid. Euploid, meaning true, truploid, the truploidy, we expect gametes to be haploid, one copy of each chromosome type. Any departure from that is called aneuploid, an unexpected number. So primary non-disjunction has to do with disjunction events occurring in a normal diploid producing aneuploid gametes with either zero or two copies of a chromosome. Secondary non-disjunction, we talk about secondary non-disjunction, secondary, in this context, X non-disjunction, because the X chromosome is not disjoining. It's the production of these gametes that we're worried about. Secondary non-disjunction starts with parent is trisomic for sex chromosomes. Okay, so that's warming you up to the lecture I'll give on Wednesday about karyotype aberrations. And as they say, yeah, sorry, one more thing, actually, question. Trisomy and monosomy, that's what causes most spontaneous abortions in humans. These things arise with embarrassing frequency in humans. We do not do meiosis all that well. Yes?
Can a trisomic male parent be fertile? And so
like with the... Yes. That the male that's trisomic by having two Ys, this one. And it's different in humans. You can look it up in a book. Okay. So, end of genes on chromosomes, on to the wonderful world of linkage. So the puzzle was, if genes are on chromosomes, we could look through a microscope and see that there aren't that many chromosomes. Okay? Yet organisms have all these characters. How does this go down the road? How do we mix characters? You know, are characters inherently stuck together if they're on the same chromosome? Okay? Well, no. And who figured that out? Answer, Thomas Hunt Morgan in 1911. He had an incredible run in his lab. Yeah, and sometimes running so dang late. I am not going to tell you. Yeah. So Morgan did two things. He he demonstrated, and I'll show you how, he demonstrated recombination. Recombination of X-linked recessives. One of the TAs pointed out to me, I said something incredibly stupid in my last lecture. I said that Lillian Morgan found this one-eyed fly in the lab. It was a female. What a dumb thing to say. Obviously, it was a male. No way in hell you're going to see a white-eyed female. Because a male, so these mutations do arise all the time, but you're only going to see it in the male because wild type is dominant. So she took this white-eyed male, bred it to normal females, then used inbreeding to produce homozygous line to produce white-eyed females. So Morgan, 1910, one demonstrated, and two, associated recombination with chiasmata. Crossing over. Physical crossing over between non-sister chromatids. So let me just run through this quickly. This is covered in your book, and again, a familiar woman figures prominently in this. This idea was nailed down by Barbara Clintock. Barbara Clintock was the first woman to get a Nobel Prize in genetics, and Barbara's first claim to fame was this experiment that I'll mention now. So suppose let's look at prophase one where each chromosome, so I'm going to consider an autosome of a metacentric chromosome. It turns out, and again, I'm sorry we don't have time to do this, but we can't do everything, that a central part of proper disjunction in most organisms is having these chromosomes synapse, have the homolog synapse, and to have these chiasmata form. Literally, what happens is, so here we have the homologs having found one another. Here are the sister chromatids. And what you see, and this is not to scale, are these strands that are crossing over. So this was first seen by this guy named Janssen. So it's the Janssen chiasmatype theory. So chiasmata, chiasma is singular. Chiasmata is plural. So this is crossover. These are non-sister chromatids crossing over and literally breaking and rejoining. That's the physical basis of recombination. And that was proven by Barbara McClintock. Clintock and another woman, Harriet Creighton. That was proven by McClintock and Creighton using chromosomes of corn that had blobs on them. So one, and distinctive blobs. So you can read about this in the book. Okay. So McClintock and Creighton used maize chromosomes, stalks of maize that were known to have these atypical looking chromosomes, and they showed that recombination of markers recombination of genes on these arms were associated with switching of these knobs between chromosomes. I won't go through the details, but you'll see how that ties in. So this is covered quite nicely in the book. Okay, more to the next. So what was happening in the Morgan lab? So Morgan discovered white, or Lilly Morgan discovered white. Morgan did this these experiments showing that it looked like white was on the X chromosome. What they instantly did was start accumulation of X chromosome mutations. The Morgan lab collect. X chromosome recessive mutations. So one was white, the next was yellow, and yellow, so typically flies are sort of tan colored. Yellow is a lack of that tan pigmentation. Has yellow, so this is a white eye, yellow body, and another X-linked. And it's easy to see that things are X-linked because you see these reciprocal cross differences, right? So Morgan, so the guy's name, Mendel, for all of his characters, it didn't matter. He had two phenotypes, didn't matter which one you used for pollen, which one you used for the ova. Okay? You got the same F1. With X linkage, you get different results from the reciprocal process. That's what we went through in detail for white, red. So there's a simple test for X linkage. And so he could quickly accumulate X linked mutations in miniature, which is a wing mutation. So it's easy to score any fly for any one of these mutations. And why do they accumulate X-linked mutations? Because males are hemizygous. So essentially all of these dramatic mutations, I mean these things that make an abnormal looking fly, you do not see abnormal looking flies in nature. You know, leave as many bananas out as you want in your kitchen, you will not see a white-eyed fly, you will not see a yellow fly, you will not see a fly with miniature wings. So they're rare. Even more rare would be seeing something that's an autosomal recessive, like scarlet. There are a bunch of eye color mutations. Well, yeah, there are mutations all over the autosomes. You're never going to see those because those loss of function mutations, you have to have two copies of them. You'd have to be homozygous for a rare allele. It's not going to happen. So much easier to accumulate X-linked recessive mutations. So what Morgan did was to find stocks. I mean, so it was a sort of a race to accumulate weird-looking flies. So he found a stock that had both white and yellow mutations together. So his first experiment on two X-linked factors So I'm going to go from Debussy violin sonata to some extraordinary Debussy.